Today is the second Sunday of Lent. It's also known as Trinity Sunday. And today we find ourselves preaching from the lectionary in the Gospel of John. We're in the third chapter of John, verses 1 through 17. This is the story, if you remember, of Nicodemus coming to Jesus. There was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I say to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved. Let's take a look at this bit of scripture bit by bit. I won't go through the whole thing, but we'll take a closer look as we go through it. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. Nicodemus is obviously a Pharisee, as you said here, a leader of the Jews. He's a member of the Sanhedrin. So he's not just an average Pharisee that's coming to Jesus. He's coming to him as one of the leaders of Israel. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these things, these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Pay attention to that word signs. We'll come back to that later. But here, he has come to Jesus at night. Now, there's much made about that. Is he coming secretly because he's a leader? I mean, does he not want the rest of the members of the Sanhedrin to know that he has come to talk to Jesus and that he has elevated Jesus by calling him rabbi, teacher? He's acknowledging Jesus as his authority, as a teacher, isn't he? He's giving him some due respect. So is this a case of him sneaking around trying to keep from being seen? Or is this a metaphor, the symbol of darkness? Is this about something, saying something about his understanding, and perhaps from there projecting that understanding upon the other members of the Sanhedrin, as well as maybe all of Israel? Are they in darkness? Are they not understanding? They're not seeing the light. Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Remember, Nicodemus is talking about the signs that Jesus is doing. And that is why he's looking at him as being something out of the ordinary. Jesus has immediately gone past that whole idea of the signs, the miracles that he's doing, and he's going right to the Spirit, isn't he? This is part of the reason why this is part of the Trinity Sunday, is because it's talking about the Holy Spirit here. Jesus' focus is on the Spirit of God. Now here we come to one of those that part of the scripture where people talk about being born again. Because here where it says, without being born from above, that word there, anathia, is the word in Greek. That word can mean a couple of different things. First of all, it can mean from above, from a higher place, as the New Revised Standard Version has translated it. It can also mean from the first, from the beginning, from the very first. Or it can mean anew and or over again. Anew or over again. So many times it's translated, as the King James Version translates it, as born anew. So that we get this, born again, Christianity. Not that there's anything wrong with that. It is a term that tends to get overused, and it's a term that tends to almost project an element of pride and a lack of, sometimes a lack of humility. That's one of the problems I have with that term for what Jesus is trying to get across here in this word. It's more than just being born anew. He's talking about being born from above, isn't he? It's about from the first, from the beginning, being born of that which is from the first, from the beginning. Of course, remember the preamble of John. Talk about the preeminence of Jesus. He's been there since the beginning. You're to be born from the Spirit. So there's much more to this than just thinking about being born anew, isn't it? You're being born of the Spirit. You're being born into the presence of God. Nicodemus, of course, doesn't quite understand this, and we're led to believe that he looks at this as being born again, right? Physical birth is what he's thinking about, because he goes on to say, how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? He's taking this literally, isn't he? Rather than looking at the metaphor that Jesus is trying to project. Now, one of the interesting things about this is that word has those multiple meanings in Greek. There's not a word that would be in Hebrew or Aramaic that would carry with it that has multiple meanings. So one can be led to wonder, is this a projection into the story by the author of John? Is John crafting this story with choosing that word? Or perhaps is Jesus communicating with Nicodemus in Greek? We don't know. But at any rate, that word is used, I think, for a reason. Not used, so we just look at it and take away from it one meaning. We need to take away from it these multiples, these layers. It's a very textured word if we want to look at it in that regard. Jesus is saying, what is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. We're born into this world twice, really. We're born into this world once, obviously, from our mother's womb. Talks about being born of water. Of course, that is water, right? We're literally born into this world from water. And then he talks about being born of the Spirit, and that is being born from above. That's truly when we talk about being born again, a born again Christian. It's that point in time when you realize and that you accept Christ as your Savior, of course. But I don't, again, I always kind of cringe at that whole thing of being born again, but it's born from above, is what it is. Born of the Spirit. Because when we look at born again, it's not being born again, is it? You're being born for the first time in the Spirit. It's not a second time being born in the Spirit. It's the first time. You have two births. One's physical, one's spiritual. Hear the wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. The word here for spirit is pneuma. The most frequent meaning of it is spirit, but it also can mean wind or breath. And we've talked about that before. Genesis, the Spirit and the waters, the breath, the breathing in creation, is the very breath of God is what we're looking at here. The Spirit of God blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it.
Again, another multiple, a word with multiple meanings, a word we need to look at in both meanings of the breath of God. Jump down to the very bottom here. No one has ascended into heaven except for the one who descended from heaven, the Son of God, or the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him may have eternal life. Here, the word we're talking about lifted up, the Greek word for pole, that this is talking about the pole that Moses lifted up with the symbol of the bronze serpent on it in the wilderness when the people were complaining and the snakes were coming and biting them. This is the pole that had the symbol of the serpent on it, which literally saved their lives and protected them from a painful death from the bites of the serpents. But here, the Greek word for pole is simeon, but it also means sign, which goes back, as a retroject, back to that beginning where Nicodemus is talking about signs, isn't he? He's seen these signs. What Jesus is talking about is you get yet to see the real sign, isn't it? Just as a serpent is lifted up on the pole, he's talking about such as that, the Son of Man will be lifted up on the cross, right? So this is another sign. So it's one of those things he's projecting back at the beginning of the verse, of the description of the verse we're dealing with. The word translated here is lifted up as hypso, which also means exalted or glorified. In the paradoxical logic, the mystery of God is the moment of a cruel and shameful death that is the triumph of eternal life. That's projected back to verse 16, which we've passed. To be exalted. He's not just lifted up. He's to be exalted. Again, that word carries with it multiple layers. This bit of scripture that we have today has at least four words in it that mean multiple things. Things that if we were to read it and understand it in Greek would give us so much more depth than what we have here in English, right? Very difficult to translate these things and carry all of these multiple meanings with it. This leads me to think that, in fact, Jesus was talking to Nicodemus in Greek, which is really intriguing because we don't often think about that. We think about him talking in Aramaic, but otherwise we're left to think John drafted this dialogue for Jesus, and then perhaps it didn't have all those layers. So I'm kind of the mind that Jesus spoke a little more Greek than we like to think, and that this conversation with Nicodemus occurred in Greek, and because of that, Jesus is using all of these words with these multiple meanings. And there may be more in there. Some of them we may have lost some of the meanings through the time. So, with that, Jesus basically kind of is done with Nicodemus, isn't he? And Nicodemus just disappears in this story. But Nicodemus doesn't disappear from the Gospel of John. Now, Nicodemus doesn't show up in the Synoptics. As we know, John is somewhat different than the Synoptics, the other three Gospels. But here, Nicodemus shows up three times in the Gospel of John. He shows up in the seventh chapter, verses 50 to 52, where he pleads in the Sanhedrin on Jesus' behalf. And then he shows up again after the crucifixion in chapter 19, when he and Joseph of Arimathea ask Pilate for the body of Jesus. And then it's Nicodemus who goes and buys a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Obviously, and this would be fairly expensive endeavor, he's the one that goes and purchases the spices in John that anoint the body of Christ before he was laid to rest in the tomb. So obviously, Nicodemus didn't just pass away. He's still there. He's still on the Sanhedrin, being at least somewhat interested in Christ, isn't he, up to this point? Interested enough that he wanted to make sure, along with Joseph, that Jesus' body was laying to rest according to the traditions and the culture with whom they lived. Now, it's also interesting that Nicodemus doesn't completely pass from the pages of history at the end of John. We know that at about the time of the destruction of the temple, around 70 AD, the Talmud mentions in several places a member of the Sanhedrin named Nicodemus, who is a follower of Jesus. That leads us to wonder, and I've talked to you before about James, the brother of, John, or of Jesus, they call him James the Just, who was martyred in 67 AD, and after he was martyred, a letter was sent to the incoming Roman governor. There was a transition of governors, and the high priest took advantage of that to have James martyred. The Pharisees, were told, wrote a letter to the incoming governor while he was still on his way to Jerusalem about this, and when the new governor got there, he immediately deposed the high priest and appointed a new one. So we're left to wonder about that. Nicodemus is there on the Sanhedrin. Is he one of the ones, or was he the one that sent that letter? Was he the reason, or was he part of the reason that James was able to preach in the temple for all those decades after Jesus' crucifixion? For a little over three decades, did James stay in the temple preaching? Nicodemus didn't just pass away. We tend to read this passage and we think of him as just disappearing into the line or into the vapor of history. He may have been much more integral and much more important to the fact that we're able to gather together and worship as Christians today. It just is another example of you never know the importance of a chance meeting, this evening visit that Nicodemus has to Christ. Now, some of you follow me on Facebook, and you have already heard this story. I want to relay this story to you as another idea about you never know what happens when you're planting seeds, to the point I'm trying to end with in this sermon. This is a story about a missionary. In 1912, medical missionary Dr. William Leslie went to live and minister to tribal people in a remote corner of the Dominican Republic of the Congo. After 17 years, he returned to the U.S. a discouraged man, believing he failed to make an impact for Christ. He died 9 years after his return. But in 2010, a team led by Eric Ramsey with Tom Cox of World Ministries made a shocking and sensational discovery. They found a network of reproducing churches hidden like glittering diamonds in the dense forest along the Kailu River from Vega, where Dr. Leslie was stationed. With the help of a Mission Aviation Fellowship, pilot Ramsey and his team flew east from Kinshash to Vega, a 2.5-hour flight in a Cessna caravan. After they reached Vega, they hiked a mile to the Kailu River and used dugout canoes to cross the half-mile-wide expanse. Then they hiked with backpacks another 10 miles into the jungle before they reached the first village of Hansai people. Based on his previous research, Ramsey thought that the Hansai in this remote area might have had some exposure to the name of Jesus, but no real understanding of who he is. They were unprepared for the remarkable find. When we got in there, we found a network of reproducing churches throughout the jungle, Ramsey reports. Each village had its own gospel choir. Although they wouldn't call it that, he notes, they wrote their own songs and would have sing-offs from village to village. They found a church in each of the eight villages they visited, scattered across 34 miles. Ramsey and his team even found a 1,000-seat stone cathedral in one of the villages. He learned that this church got so crowded in the 1980s that many walked miles to attend, that a church planting movement began in the surrounding villages. There is no Bible in the Yansi language, Ramsey said. They use a French Bible, so those who taught had to be fluent in French. Apparently, Dr. Leslie crossed the Kailu River once a year from Vega, and spent a month traveling through the jungle, carried by servants in a sedan chair. He would teach the Bible and taught the tribal children how to read and write, talked about the importance of education, and told Bible stories, Ramsey notes. Dr. Leslie started the first organized educational system in those villages, Ramsey learned. It took some digging for Ramsey to uncover Leslie's identity. The tribal people only knew him by one name, and I didn't know if that was a first or last name. They knew he was a Baptist, and he was based in that one city, and they knew the years. When Ramsey returned home, he did some additional investigation and discovered that Dr. Ramsey was affiliated with the American Baptist Missionary Union. The American Baptist Missionary Union was founded in 1914 by Adrian and Judson, who led a pioneering work in Burma. Born in Ontario, Canada, William H. Leslie followed his intended profession as a pharmacist until his conversion in 1888. He moved to the Chicago area where God began to grip his heart with the desire to become a medical missionary. Dr. Leslie initiated his Congo service in 1893 at Benzai Matique. 2 years later, he developed a serious illness. A young missionary named Clara Hill took care of him until he recovered. Their budding friendship ripened into love and a marriage proposal. They were wed in 1896. In 1905, William and Clara pioneered a work in Kulu, Angola, where they overcame a hurricane that struck the night before one of their children was born, and more mundane obstacles like charging buffaloes and army vans. 7 years later, they cleared enough of the leopard-infested jungle near the Kwilu River at Bagan for a new missionary station perched on a small plateau. Some of the villages surrounding Bagan were still practicing cannibalism at that time. They spent 17 years at Bagan, but their service ended on a rocky note. Dr. Leslie had a relational falling out with some of the tribal leaders and was asked not to come back. Ramsey says, they reconciled later, there were apologies and forgiveness, but it didn't end like he hoped. His goal was to spread Christianity. He felt like he was there for 17 years, and he never really made a big impact. But the legacy he left is huge. Can you imagine that? It's 1912 that he's down there, and it's 2010 and they come back and find this network of churches. And a church that can see 1,000 people. That these people have created it on their own after he had left so many years before. Truly that, and as it says, a man went to his grave thinking that what he had done is phenomenal. We can read the story of Nicodemus and think that Jesus' visit with him at this point in the chapter is for naught if we just didn't know the little tidbits more and if we didn't have the story in the tongue to tell us about. Such is the same as our lives. We live our life, we can wonder if we have an impact, if we make any difference. We don't know. I've said it before. That's not up to us to know. All of it is up to us to do is to do the work we're called to do, to plant the seeds, to be there for people. Do what we're called to do in Christ and leave the rest of it to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for allowing us to be your hands and feet. Forgive us for the times when our pride and our ego want to see the results of our labors, Lord. But let us understand that no matter what, even when we feel that we've been unsuccessful, even when we feel that what we're doing is for naught, Lord, we understand that out of these things, you can raise up churches and networks of churches, and you can create and do good things. We pray all this in your loving and glorious name.